How can something we hear have meaning on paper? Why do bands always count off 1, 2, 3, 4? And what exactly is a treble clef? Hi, I'm Ava Kelly, and we'll talk about basic music notation and how to start making sense of it all on this episode of How To Music. Music is a language, and just like learning Italian or Mandarin, your brain on music is learning how to communicate with a completely new vocabulary. Basically, reading and writing in music is just as important as it is to read and write in any other language. Imagine if you went to France, and you knew how to speak the language, so you got around in Paris just fine. But say you decided to move there and to live in Marseille. If you couldn't read or write in French, you wouldn't be able to read the road signs, and you wouldn't be able to text with your French friends. At some point, you're gonna want to learn the language. So, for this video, let's think of music like the elements of a language. The background for all written music is the staff. Think of the staff as your new alphabet, and each line or space as a different letter with endless possibilities of words to make up. Just as you can put together different letters to make words and phrases, you can put different pitches and notes on the staff to create chords and melodies. Typically, when you look at a piece of music, you'll see two staffs, one on top and one on the bottom, connected by a mustache, which is technically called a bracket. Why are there multiple staffs, and why are they connected with a mustache? Think of how a pianist plays multiple notes on the piano with both their right and their left hand. In order to show what they're playing, we use two staffs and connect them with a giant mustache and then call it a grand staff. Fancy, huh? Well, so are mustaches. On the grand staff, you're usually working with treble clef, represented by this guy, and bass clef, represented by this backward C-looking thing. Quick tip, always think treble T for top, bass clef B for bottom. If you're in treble clef, the sounds are going to be higher pitched, think of a woman singing. And if you're in bass clef, they're going to be lower pitched, like a man singing. Another way to think about this is on the piano. So if you watch a pianist play, their right hand is typically playing in the treble clef, while their left hand is typically playing in the bass clef. Also, even though they're not terribly common, there are other clefs, such as alto clef, that's used a lot by violists, because violas kind of play in this weird range between treble clef and bass clef. But by far the most common are treble and bass. Okay, so in a piece of music, each line is separated by bar lines. And in between each of these bar lines is a measure. You can kind of think of the bar lines like the space between words in a language. And so each measure would be a word. Another one of those music-y things at the beginning of a piece is called a time signature. The time signature tells you how to interpret the rhythmic notation. The top number tells you how many beats are going to fit into a measure, while the bottom number tells you exactly which note is going to get one beat. In a way, the time signature is telling you what language you're in. Letters and words in French are pronounced differently than they are in Spanish, and the idea is the same here. So, if the top number is a 3, that means we get 3 beats in each measure. If it changes to a 4, we now have 4 beats in each measure. Quick tip, notice I use the word beats and not notes. In music, beats are steady, while the length of notes can vary. So, there could be any number of notes in a measure, but only as many beats as are indicated in the time signature. Now let's move on to the bottom number. I said earlier that the bottom number tells you which note gets one beat. So if the bottom number is 4, then the quarter note gets the beat. It could be 2 and the half note would get the beat, or it could be 8 and the eighth note would get the beat. This is all a little confusing, but just know that by far the most common number here is 4, which means the quarter note gets the beat. And I'll explain all of this more in the episode on rhythm. Speaking of rhythm, let's move on to the notes themselves. So, you've probably seen music before, and if you're anything like my high school government teacher, you thought it looked like fly poop on paper. But it's so much more than that. So each note can tell us two basic things, which pitch to play or sing, and for how long. The rhythmic value of the note is the length of the note, or how long you hold the note for. I can hold a note for 1 beat, or 3 beats, or a half a beat, and all of these are represented by different notes. The pitch of the note, or whether we sing it high or low, is represented by the placement of this note on the staff. If you see a note placed very low on the bass clef, it's going to have a lower sound. And if you see a note placed high on treble clef, it's obviously going to have a much higher sound. When you put all these different pitches together in different lengths of time in an organized manner, you get melodies and chords and music. Just like when you put letters together into words and phrases and sentences, you get beautiful languages that can tell you stories or give you news or tell you to turn left. Music has a language of its own, and we're only just starting to learn it. At the end of each song is a double bar line. This is kind of like the end. And this is the end of this episode of How To Music. I'm Ava Kelly. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time.